Welcome back to Talking Baseball. I'm Ed Randall with the Hall of Famer Phil Rizzuto, who had what he said was his most fulfilling birthday ever this past September when he helped the victims of 9/11 here in New York City. Back to baseball. You have said that there would be no broadcasting career for you if it were not for Mel Allen.
Oh, true. Absolutely.
Really?
Oh, I mean, I used to talk through my nose. He said the only bad thing about Mel, he would correct me on the air. My mother was furious. I mean, I put an R on everything. Gary Jewell used to flip. I'd say Cuba. You know, it's typical Brooklyn, you know. Yeah. R's on everything, and he'd correct me. And I would say Philadelphia Athletics. Mel would say, Phil, it's no A in it. It's Philadelphia Athletics.
On the air.
On the air.
Ow!
So anyway, I learned, you know, that way you learn. One good thing about it is it wouldn't happen again.
Right.
Another thing, but I still think I'm right in it when they say, you can say it both ways, the word, anyway. And I would say, it's going to be one of those, forget that, because it's going to be one of those things like I did with Bill Terry before. isn't that something? Route and root.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I would say we're taking the route, and Mel would say on the air, "No, it's route. Mm-hmm. Route is something else when you chase somebody or you route something." And that was, my mother had them all marked down. And our poor Mel is gone, but yeah. He was great. No, he was like a conductor of an orchestra. He could start a game and in the middle. And build a crescendo, not like me. I got excited in the first pitch and hit, and I'd yell all through the broadcast.
Listen to this list. 40 years in the booth, alphabetically, these are the people this man worked with. Mel Allen, Red Barber, Pam Boucher, Rick Cerrone, Jerry Coleman, Whitey Ford, Bob Gamier, Joe Gargiola, George Grant, John Gordon, Hawk Harrelson, Fran Healy, Jim Cott, Mickey Mantle, I'm only at the M's, Billy Martin, Frank Messer, Bobby Mercer, Paul Olden, Spencer Ross, Tom Seaver, Bill White, Dom Valentino. I talked to White recently, which was a big deal getting him on the phone, as you know, and he said that in 18 years together, you and he, his words, never had a crossword.
Right, never. I look forward to going every day. Well, he was really great, and he saved me a lot of times, because, Cora, she said to me, look, she said, be careful when you're talking on the air. She says, everybody else has got a little trapdoor in the back of their head, and your thought goes in there, and it's the trapdoor says, should I do it? You do it. She says, yours is open all the time. And one time, I guess it's not too late, or it might. Anyway, Patrick Ewing had just come to the Knicks, mm-hmm. right? And Bill and I were talking. And then that morning, they had a picture on the paper of him and the Empire State Building. And I said on the air, it looks just like King Kong. He grabbed my wrist. I thought he was going to break it, because if I had kept it up, I'd have been like Howard Cosell. You know how he got in trouble when he...
Yeah, right, with Alvin Garrett, the little monkey remark, yeah.
But it looked just like...
And Cosell was a guy who said you'd never make it,
yes,
right?
Yes, he did, Cosell. He said, you'll never make it. Your voice is no good for radio or TV.
40 years later, calls. Roger Maris is 61st, Chambliss with the home run in the bottom of the ninth, Bucky Dent. Anyone stand out? Anything stand out?
No, the home run Mantle, the two home runs other than that Mickey Mantle hit in Washington.
The 565
hit off the scoreboard. And then the one where he just missed by the most 6 inches of hitting it out of Yankee Stadium. Now they've built up the...
Right, you can't.
You can't do it, but, I mean, you talk
What was the secret to your success as a broadcaster?
I think because I hated to give statistics. I'd let all the other guys read through and give the statistics. And then I wouldn't talk baseball all the time. I'd give cooking lessons.
Talk about the cannoli delivery.
Cannolis, and birthdays. Oh, birthday, I was big on birthday. People loved it. I get letters, and they just...
I miss that now, don't you?
No, I don't. The fans do, but I don't. I mean, I loved doing it. It was so easy. It was, you know.
Some broadcasters have done it and continue to do it. Ernie Harwell does it in Detroit still. But we don't do that anymore, and that's unfortunate. What was the best part of being a broadcaster for the Yankees?
Well, you knew it was going to be an exciting game, and that they'd almost always be in the World Series. And but I knew that I had set it up beautifully, because the story about me getting hit when I was in the minor leagues, lightning hit and killed the center fielder that we had, and this was Class D, my first year in Bassett, that was Bassett, Virginia, and knocked all the rest of the players down. Cuban catcher was praying. And so after that, every time lightning came, they know that I was going to leave. Oh, I got out of so many early games. Jerry Coleman said, "So long, Phil," he'd yell. And I'd go.
That was your excuse to be on the George Washington Bridge and be home.
So I did. That was one of the big things. But it was always good because the games were exciting. And it was, they always went for the big players. They always had great players on the team.
Yeah.
And you really enjoyed doing the games.
But not a guy to go into the locker room, talk to the players before.
Oh, I never went on the field after that. Never.
Right. Just come in and do the game.
Do the game.
And did him so well for 40 years, and boy, we miss him in the booth. We are with Hall of Famer Phil Rizzuto, number 10, a number that will never, ever again be worn by a New York Yankee. And we will continue with him right after this.